making the sound and swishing it about with spinning wheels. But no one had thought of putting a voice through it before. Radical idea number four.
And radical idea number five was the McCartney-led use of tape loops running on a chain of five additional machines mixed live onto the master track. The Beatles were deep in uncharted waters, not just for pop, but for any kind of music. They took what they learnt from Tomorrow Never Knows and applied aspects of it, especially the reverse tape effects, to many of their other songs, particularly John Lennon's masterly Strawberry Fields Forever.
Welcome to episode 34 of Glass Onion on John Lennon, and today is the second part of my talk with Jason Barnard of the Strange Brew podcast, and today we're talking about what we think are John Lennon's best songs. I'm very excited about presenting today's episode. I think, in fact, along with the Revolution 9 episode from December, that was episode 25, I'm going to say this is my favourite of the ones I've done so far. One of the reasons is that the audio clips, I think, have been adding a lot to the episodes. And I went to town a bit today, I've got to be honest. There are multiple, a plethora, a smorgasbord, in fact, of audio clips accompanying our talk today. What you heard at the beginning there was Howard Goodall talking about one of John Lennon's most famous songs. So a little bit of a spoiler for today, but it was such a good clip that I didn't worry too much about revealing one of our picks in advance. Incidentally, Howard Goodall is probably best known still in England for composing the Blackadder theme. But he's done some brilliant documentaries. I'm going to link to one of them, actually, which was he did a series called 20th Century Greats, and included, I think, Bernstein and Cole Porter, and then he had the Beatles in there. That was a fantastic show. And he's done some other great stuff about music. Nearly all of it is, in fact, on YouTube, so free to view. So Jason and I both picked five songs, as we did with the quote-unquote worst songs. And one of the really magical things about the conversation we had was that, as you'll hear us say later, as we were talking about the songs and kind of riffing on them and, you know, feeding off each other's enthusiasm for them, the songs started to get better and better, you know, in our minds. And it was an amazing thing, but fully justified. I mean, some of the stuff we're going to talk about today, I know I'm a bit biased, but really I think some of it is the pinnacle of popular music, the pop rock genre, let's say. So among the other clips, you're going to hear Jeff Emerick. There's some stuff from the John Lennon Plastic Ono Band Classic Albums episode. Highly recommended. There's some of that on YouTube, not the whole thing. There's obviously John Lennon himself at certain times. There's an isolated track. There's also a couple of composite mixes, which is basically where, rather than playing the finished song, you play certain elements of the song and then you change it. So the beginning of the song will be isolated bass or drums, for example. And then it will progress to isolated guitar or whatever it is, strings. So there's that as well. There's another musicologist as well as Howard Goodall. There's some interviews as well from Jason's show. And there are some musicians who work with John Lennon on certain things. There's a demo as well. I think you're really going to enjoy this. And it's, in fact, the longest podcast I've ever done as well. But I don't think it'll get boring at any point. I decided I wasn't going to talk about what was happening in the world at the moment. As I said last time, I want this podcast to kind of exist as an escape, as some entertainment away from the harsh realities that are happening at the moment. So in fact, I'm going to leave it there and I'm going to let you get on with listening to today's show, and I'll be back on the other side with a few words. Enjoy. All right, let's get to the good stuff, shall we? So chronologically, what's your first one for best John Lennon song?
My first best John Lennon song actually takes us up to 1966. Mm-hmm. So we go straight into that, for me, that classic Beatles period where they really grew as artists, and for me that would be Tomorrow Never Knows.
Oh, yes. Go for it.
I think we might be playing an excerpt of when I was talking to Jeff Emerick about this.
But yes, I mean, that was when I was dropped in the deep end when Norman Smith left, you know, the original recording engineer, and that was the first track they recorded for the Revolver album, and It started by John wanting this magical voice, you know, the Dalai Lama singing, you know, on a mountaintop 20 miles away from the studio. You know, there's no software in those days and no plugins, so my saving grace there was the revolving speaker from the Hammond organ, which was called a Leslie speaker, and we put John's voice through that. And that sort of won John over, in fact, in a big way, because he just loved the sound of that. And then Ringo wanted a different drum sound, and we got that. And, you know, Paul wanted a much stronger bass sound, and we got that. So that was like the beginning, really.
Sonically, it had that magic combination of the Beatles, George Martin, Jeff Emerick, and George helped facilitate some of those ideas from John, you know, the Dalai Lama, John's voice through the Leslie speaker, Ringo's drum sound, Paul's bass, etc. I mean, it's just magic. And I mean, the Chemical Brothers were recreating that sound 30 years later.
Yeah, they were. You're right.
You've got to think, this is 1966, and 3 or 4 years earlier it was Love Me Do. I mean, what a leap. That sort of leap in sound and creation and sonically in such a short span of time is magical, and this song just works on so many levels.
And it was on Revolver that, of course, we have the track Tomorrow Never Knows, which was a great innovation.
That's me and my Tibetan Book of the Dead period. And the expression Tomorrow Never Knows was another of Ringo's. So I gave it a throwaway title because I was a bit self-conscious about the lyrics of Tomorrow Never Knows. So I took one of Ringo's malapropisms, which was like Hard Day's Night, and to take the edge off the heavy philosophical lyrics.
John had this song which was all on the chord of C, which in our minds was okay, like Indian music's all on one chord, it's a perfectly good idea. I was wondering how George Martin was going to take it, because it was a bit of a radical departure, you know, at least we'd had three chords, and maybe a change for the middle eight even, you know. Suddenly this was just John just strumming on C rather earnestly, and you know, lay down your mind existence.
In those days there was no technology like there is now. I mean, there was two guitars, bass and drums, and that was it. We did stuff in the studio with the aid of recording tricks, then we couldn't just reproduce them on stage. Like nowadays you could do Tomorrow Never Knows, have all the loops up there on a keyboard, kind of emulator stuff, and you could have as many piano players and drummers and, you know, orchestras, whatever you wanted. But in those days, that's it. We were just a little dance hall band, and we never really thought of augmenting ourselves.
And the drums, yeah, unbelievable as well. I don't know how much more to say about it. It's just a magic song. And it's a bit like, where do you go from now? Because there's some brilliant stuff on Pepper, and obviously my other tracks are later on as well, but this is up there as, you know, almost a perfect track.
Yeah, I mean, no argument here. I mean, I've got in my notes 3 years from me to you. Exactly 3 years. I remember years and years ago. Well, I'll tell you when it was. It was about early 2000s. I was listening to the radio at home, and Danny Baker played it, and he said, that song is 35 years old, so that must have been 2001. And he said, it still sounds 35 years in the future. I think the marriage of the sort of avant-garde tape loops with a fairly commercial song, in the sense of... You know, I don't know if commercial is quite the word for it, but it's accessible. Magic is the word. I mean, it's just fantastic. And I mean, the original version, you know, you've heard that one that sort of sounds a bit underwater.
Yeah.
I'm really pleased they remade it, you know. Beatles remade quite a lot of songs, didn't they, from scratch. It was quite a trademark. The lyrics, of course, came from the Leary book, which John would have seen in the Indica bookshop. Just a slight tangent. Have you read Many Years From Now, the McCartney?
I have.
I remember getting that at the time. And I remember the headline in Q or Mojo, one of those magazines, was the caption was, "I was cool, honest." And he got very derided for sort of claiming things. But the more I look at it, the more, you know, he was involved in the opening of the Indica bookshop. And John kind of stole that because he met Yoko in that bookshop. And in addition to that, you know, the famous Montague Square flat, you know, obviously John and Yoko did Two Virgins, Jimi Hendrix lived there. But before either of them, McCartney had helped convert that flat into a studio for Zappel, which is, again, became famous because of John and Yoko and George. And he recorded William Burroughs doing Spoken Word. So Macca was there before John Lennon. John Lennon was kind of getting stoned in Surrey, you know, in suburbia. So Macca gets a lot of credit for that. It's funny that they only had maybe a couple of verses, and you wouldn't think for a second that the song could sustain maybe without the tape loops. But there's a cover by a guy called Junior Parker, and it's just a straight verses, and it does sustain. So there must be something in that melody as well. You know, it didn't need the adornments, but I mean, no argument for me. That's a great choice.
I think it's the product of six individuals, if you count Jeff and George Martin in there as well, who combined perfectly, all at their peak, and throwing ideas into the pot. So it is a John song, but actually for me it was a brilliant collaboration between all of them.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great. Okay, my first pick, I really did want to pick one from Rubber Soul. Perhaps the more obvious ones would have been In My Life and perhaps Nowhere Man. In My Life, I think, is probably close to a 50-50 collaboration. That's one of the ones they disagree about, John and Paul. The melody is very McCartney for me because it moves around quite a bit. That's what prevents me choosing In My Life. So I'm going to choose Girl. You know, funnily enough, from what you were just saying and we were just saying about the progress, they recorded Girl soon after they come back from America in 65, and they'd just done Shea Stadium. And, you know, I think they enjoyed Shea Stadium, but there would have been some of it that would just seem ridiculous. I mean, 20 minutes, can't really hear yourself. The recording of Shea Stadium was very much spruced up in the studio, which they did at the beginning of 66. But the sort of gulf between what they're doing at Shea Stadium and what they're recording with something like Girl is quite amazing. And I was looking at Wikipedia and a few other things, and there's a good website called The Beatles Bible, and I was doing a bit of research. It was interesting that on this album, there's a couple of examples of sort of Euro pop, if you want to call it that, in the best sense of the word. Not Eurovision, but Paul had his French one, Michel. And this one was brilliantly described by Ian MacDonald, who wrote that book, Revolution in the Head. Yeah, a decadent German two-step combined with Zorba the Greek. It has got this sort of, I think it's like a German rhythm, but it does sound very Greek. I actually thought for a long time they had, what do you call it, bouzouki? Is that what it's called? But it turns out that it was just 2 6-string acoustics and 1 12-string, and they're capoed very high, I think on the 8th fret, to get that kind of sound. So it's got so many things going for it. And then you've got the lyrics, you know, what she told when she was young that pain would lead to pleasure, which could be a comment on Christianity. But Paul McCartney did claim that line for himself. And he claimed the line that a man must break his back to earn his day of leisure, which in a funny way harks back to Hard Day's Night. You know, I've been working like a dog. And it's that funny identification with the sort of common man going to work, even though the Beatles never really had proper jobs. They seem to be able to identify. And then you've got the whole thing with the intake of breath, which is partly marijuana, could be a sexual reference. You've got the tit backing vocals. And the whole idea, I think John's quote was that this is about a sort of fantasy girl that turned out to be Yoko, I suppose, and then he updated it with Woman in 1980. I was listening to it this morning, and the more I was reading about it, the higher the regard I held it in. You know, and Rubber Soul's got a lovely mixture of sort of very hummable melodies, but lots of sophistication. So, do you like this song?
Yeah, I don't know what more to add. I think it's from that period where they were experimenting with sounds in the studio, but possibly in a bit more of a subtle way. We were talking earlier about, for me, John Lennon, there's a bit of a window on to his soul and a bit of honesty, and I think it certainly feels there's some very interesting lyrics there, observations. It's certainly a big leap forward, especially lyrically. A fine song. I don't know if I'd have it in my top five, but it's definitely in my top list. A great Lennon song, and actually a song that really does feel Lennon-esque.
Yeah, I would say, though, that from the books I've read, it seems like, you know, there's all this debate about how much did they write together and how long did they write together for. Mm. It seems to me that Rubber Soul was an album where they did have quite regular writing sessions, and there's a few co-writes. Like I say, I Think In My Life was a co-write. Drive My Car was a co-write. Something like Norwegian Wood was mostly John, and then Paul apparently had the idea of setting the house on fire. The Word is a co-write. Wait is a co-write, although that's a bit of a hangover from the previous album. So it could be that Paul came up with a couple of lines. It just, they don't really sound like Paul lines, do they?
No.
You know, so, you know, we're probably never going to know that one. All right, we're going to get into the meat now. So give us your next one.
Okay, so my next track is A Day in the Life.
Mm-hmm.
And I know before this podcast we were talking about whether it was a John song, but I think the core of this is definitely John. The McCartney bit, Woke Up, Got Out of Bed, is great as a sort of middle eight or as a shift, but actually the core of this song, what makes it great, as well as the production that was added to it, and I think that Paul was pushing Jeff Emmerich and George Martin to get a sound on this and aim big. It really is, for me, a John song in every way, really, and possibly the best Beatles song. And if it's the best Beatles song, it's up there with the best song ever made, really.
Yeah.
I mean, there's the backstory about it, you know, in regard to their friend Tara Brown, the millionaire. But the way it mixes observations that were going around at the time of fragments of life and what was going on with John at the time. So you've got the death of Tara Brown, you've got, you know, the reference to the war and the film with Richard Lester, How I Won the War.
Absolutely.
Then you've got reading the newspaper, 4,000 Holes in Blackburn, Lancashire. But actually, you could say that there was a newspaper element in relation to Tara Brown as well. So lyrically, and welding those fragments together into something that is true, but actually almost psychedelic in terms of segueing and mixing those topics together. Then you've got, on top of those brilliant lyrics, the production, and I think we'll be playing a segment where I was speaking to Jeff Emmerich about that, and Jeff was talking about, there's a great moment where Jeff talks about making a rough mix for the playback, and Ron Richards, who was the Hollies producer, was basically talking about, I'm just going to give up the business now.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the phrase turning black and white to Technicolor.
Because when we made that record, you had to be there the night that we actually put the orchestra on. Richard, who was my assistant, and myself, we did the rough monitor mix to, you know, so everyone could hear it back, which was a little tricky at that time. But we did it, and, you know, a few of the Rolling Stones were there and a few other invited guests, and they were standing in the control room. And so was Ron Richards, who was the Hollies producer, who was sitting on the floor. So eventually we get it together and we play back our monitor mix, which is just a sort of a mock-up mix, not the final mix. And it was just unbelievable. Everyone was sort of open-mouthed at the end of it. And Ron Richards, who was sitting on the floor, he had his head in his hands, and he said, I'm just going to give the business up because I know I can't get anywhere near that. I mean, you really had to experience that night what happened, because it was like going from a square black and white picture into like CinemaScope Technicolor. It was just unbelievable.
Also, we're talking about Tomorrow Never Knows. I think this is certainly up there and is a song that is very difficult to surpass and ahead of its time.
Yeah. If push came to shove, I would say this song or my next pick, which I'll come to in a second, would be my best Beatles songs. Of course, you know, different eras of their career. I Want to Hold Your Hand is perfect at what it is. But this is just, I mean, Jeff Emerick summed it up fairly well, and he was there, of course. I mean, perfect.
Which one's that?
The right-hand one.
Far right.
I'm not always a great believer that albums have to have a definitive running order. I think if you've grown up with a certain running order, that might seem like the right one. But this, as a closer to Sgt. Pepper, I can't see at any other point in the album. I mean, I used to listen to Sgt. Pepper on like the 40th anniversary. I listened on June the 1st. Which it turns out wasn't the release date. It was actually rush released the week before, but June the 1st sounds like a great date because it sounds like the beginning of summer. Pepper is not my favourite album. It hasn't been for a while, Beatles. But Day in the Life was so powerful that at the end of the experience of listening to that album, and I sort of used to listen to it on headphones sort of at 9 o'clock in the morning when my senses were quite sharp, it just validated the whole album. It's that powerful. What do you think the song is about? Is there a deeper meaning to it, do you think, or what does it do for you?
That's an interesting question. Escape, kind of going to a different place. It does really take you on a trip. a dizzying array of little nuggets. So maybe it's about consciousness or...
Yeah, I mean, that sounds good. I mean, I think the fact that it doesn't have a definitive meaning is one of the things that's magic about it, I think. Mm. I'm just going to play another clip, if you don't mind. I found this clip, and it's a musicologist. It's from a documentary I saw, and it's him describing some of the musical elements of it in terms of doubt and uncertainty.
Is that Howard Goodall?
No, it isn't. It's another guy. I don't know his name. It's a documentary called Composing the Songbook or something. It's a guy going, and then it goes from the dominant key of E minor to this and blah, blah, blah. And it's quite a fun clip, actually. So we'll play that now. So
I think that there are some very interesting things about a day in the life, which I'll demonstrate, and then try and suggest how you can make sense of them. It's a very unusual song. I'm not talking about that great orchestral section in the middle or at the end. I mean, that's obvious that that's weird. But Day in the Life is weird at other levels too. It's a song that's in the key of G. What we don't get, and what we would usually get with a song in the key of G, would be that sort of cadence somewhere to really confirm the key. That doesn't happen here. So there's a sense of, well, it's a sort of rather weak, apologetic key, whatever key it is. Then if you listen to the melody, the melody actually outlines E minor. It outlines a totally different key. So there's a sense in which the melody and the harmony can't even decide what key this is in. So doubt is at the root of A Day in the Life, it seems to me, musically. And there's one other very, very interesting thing. If you take the opening verse, two, three, four, five, and then we go on. We're used to things being in fours. The first verse happens to be over a span of five, as I've just counted. Now, on its own, that's trivial. But then if you listen to McCartney's middle section, one, two, three, four, five. Five again. That section is based on fives. Then if you listen to... five. And back again. Even that. So we've got three basic musical ideas in the song. All of them are based on five. What are we to make of these? It seems to me that Day in the Life, because Sergeant Pepper is fictional, Day in the Life is outside that fiction. So we have to interpret Day in the Life as some sort of externality to the fiction. In other words, something identifiably real. So it's speaking of our situation. This is 1967. And the counterculture is telling us that there's a new way of living which will be better for us. And it's based on an alternative conception of time, a psychedelic conception of time. What do the Beatles do here? They give us A Day in the Life, which is fundamentally based on an altered conception of time, fives rather than fours, and yet they cannot really sign up to it because of doubts about the way that Day in the Life is built. So it seems to me that this beautifully symbolizes the failure of the counterculture years before it happens.
Tim Riley, in a book called Tell Me Why, I think he's a musicologist, he said, as with Strawberry Fields, Lennon uses a device where free-form lyrics allow a greater freedom of expression and create a supernatural calm. Supernatural calm. I'd like some of that in my life. Mm. And the clip I played is sort of, yeah, uncertainty, but with everyday life. And as you said, it does the same trick that almost like Wizard of Oz does, which is about telling you about how amazing it is to be out there in the world, in a magical world. But also it's nice to come home. And, you know, that's not a definitive interpretation, but it's the way I kind of feel. That's what John Lennon kind of does for me. Paul McCartney's very good at the coming home bit, the everyday person bit. you know, he was good at contributing to John's songs, like Tomorrow Never Knows, but I don't think there's too many Paul McCartney. You know, he gets close to it, like Fixing a Hole, you know. I'm fixing a hole, my mind. He's talking about his mind and my mind goes wandering and all that kind of thing. He was good at it around 67, but I think John Lennon's the master of that, taking you to another world, but then kind of bringing you back home or bringing you back to something relatable. But as I said, and as you said, I think it's a big contender for best Beatles song, for sure. Can I go on to the next one?
Well, you've got another contender for the best Beatles song, though, haven't you?
I have, yeah, yeah. Effortless segue once again. So my next one is Strawberry Fields Forever, of course. Again, I'll go through just the basic story of the composition, because I don't want to presume that all the listeners will know all this stuff. But, you know, he went to Almeria in Spain, and I used to live in Spain. I never got to Almeria, unfortunately, to make This How I Won the War, the film you just mentioned before. While he was there, he was very bored. He was smoking a lot of weed. He was reading a lot of books. And it was this amazing period of the Beatles where they took this break of 3 or 4 months, or break from each other. You know, George went to India, and I think his life was just changed beyond recognition. Ringo founded a company called Bricky Builders. Poor old Ringo. Although, in a way, you know, he was the happiest of the four, wasn't he? The fact that he'd nearly died when he was young from having these diseases, he appreciated his life. Paul did The Family Way with George Martin, and John did How I Won the War. But they had this sort of 3-4 months apart, and they came back. John, of course, started composing this in Spain. There's a whole sort of bootleg of all this sort of gradual progression of this song. And he was reading a book called Report to Greco, and it's about a writer looking for spiritual meaning. He was also reading Hindu books, apparently, and the Nothing Is Real, which is one of the sort of central motifs of it, came from the idea of Maya, which is illusion, which in Hindu texts features, you know, this idea of, you know, perhaps everything is an illusion and shouldn't get too attached to it. So they come back in November. They've all got moustaches. We don't know. I don't know if you know whether they sort of rang each other up and said, well, I've grown a moustache. Oh, well, I'll grow a moustache. But they seem to come back as people who'd sort of aged 4 years in 4 months, you know, in terms of all the innocence seemed to have gone. I mean, from the outside, you know, I'm sure in the studio there was an element where they were still the same sort of joking around, but it seems like their whole worlds, perhaps except Ringo, seemed to have changed. I mean, they spent 45 hours on this song, 3 weeks. They did 3 versions, in fact. The famous story is, of course, joining the 2 versions. As for what it's about, I mean, John Lennon said it's psychoanalysis set to music. Originally, they were going to make an album about their childhood, so that's where the Strawberry Fields is a Salvation Army home, and then Penny Lane came. And the quote from 1980 said, I was different all my life. Nobody is in my tree means nobody is as hip as me. Therefore, I must be crazy or a genius, high or low.
Good morning, listeners, and welcome to that amazing, incredible Kenny Everett show of the Swing in England set. A lot of records playing, and, you know, generally get together.
Strawberry Fields. It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? Well, let me, how's it go?
Let me take you down, that's it.
Yeah. It's just about me, really. Mm. Or anybody else that is thinking like that.
Yeah.
It's just a random
it's
question.
It's just,
I mean, it says it here. What does it say? It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? It's just
A
bit of messy, and then let's get away to Strawberry Fields. It's just, you know. It's fantastic to me, maybe, at certain points when you're doing it.
Mm.
And then after that, you can't listen to it objectively. And it takes till about now, say, to really listen to it and understand what you're really talking about.
And then I like the sort of, yes. It's supposed to be, to me, sort of trying to sound like natural speech rather than these kind of smooth pop lyrics. And I think the LSD and everything, it sort of contributes to this sort of nightmare world of visions and a kind of haunted childhood. I mean, he did have a rough childhood, and there was a lot of death in his life. He wasn't really an orphan. He had a fairly stable upbringing with his aunt and uncle. And then his uncle died when he was 14. I think Nowhere Boy, the film, sort of covered all this fairly well. Obviously, a lot of credit goes to Paul for the Mellotron opening.
This is a 1966 Mellotron, a very rare piece of gear. It's a keyboard instrument. The thing that you heard at the beginning of Strawberry Fields Forever was played on this machine. And what it does is a little bit of tape records an instrument playing, say strings, and when you press the key, that tape plays back. Those were strings, and here's some brass. So it's been superseded by modern technology and sampling and computers and all those sort of things, but this is what they had back in the late 60s, and it's an amazing piece of wonderful historic gear.
We found other uses for it, as have many musicians since, and probably the most famous use we as the Beatles put it to was on the front of one of our records, which went like this.
George did that sort of with a thing, I think it's called a swar mandal or something, an Indian instrument. And then George Martin did this amazing score, which makes you wonder whether he was, you know, an LSD freak on the side. Like, how did he tap into all this stuff? You know, how was he in tune with them when they seemed to be off on this whole other trip? But anyway, that's my interpretation. What do you think?
Yeah, you talked about the different versions of this, and we'll be playing a segment of Jeff Emmerich talking about how he got his brass scissors out and did a crossfade.
Again, I assume this is featured heavily in the sessions, and that's Strawberry Fields. And again, you had a major role in how that track took shape in the studio.
I'm trying to try and condense the story. John recorded Strawberry Fields and was quite happy with it. And 2 weeks later, he came back and said, I want to re-record it. I think we can do a better job on it. And I want it to be more strident and aggressive at the end, using, you know, orchestral instruments. So it was recorded for a second time. And then John came back and said, well, I really like the first half of the first version that we did 2 weeks ago, but the second half of the new version that we've just done. But the problem was they were different tempos and different keys. So what we had to do was to copy our mixes that we'd done, with the tape machines being on vary speed, and then record it on a third machine, which was the... So we sent the... I might get this the wrong way around. We sent the first half... I had to speed it up or slow it down slightly to marry with the tempo and the key of the second tape, or the second version, which was on vary speed. And I think I slowed that down to begin with and then gradually sped it up as it reached the end. And then the actual edit is on the word down, which is about a minute into the song. But I had to do a funny sort of scissory edit, because we didn't have razor blades to do edits. EMI didn't have razor blades. We used brass scissors. Okay. So I made a little cardboard sort of template up with a couple of marks on. So it wasn't like a 45 degree angle. It was more like a crossfade. It was quite a long cut, which was about an inch long, I guess, maybe longer. And it was like a crossfade rather than just a butted up edit. But it actually works, you know.
We have the combination of slower take and then into a take with more production, you know, the drums. George Martin really starts coming in that bigger production, but then it works as kind of a way into the track, and as it builds and builds.
What about the drums as well?
Oh, God.
On that drum track, I think it's either on the left or the right channel, that sort of thunderous tribal drumming. I think apparently there's quite a few people on that. It's not just Ringo.
Right.
I'm sure one of the other documentaries, there's a few other people sort of adding percussion to it, but obviously just... you know, the trademark Ringo fills. My criticism of him as a drummer might be that it was a bit heavy-handed at times. But on this, it just works, doesn't it? It's so tribal.
There's something great about the drumming in this period where it isn't that traditional drumming style. It's that syncopated, where it's not necessarily on the beat where you would expect it to be, and there's more fills, and then it varies and rolls. I think this song almost combines everything into a cacophony of thunderous drums, but it works.
Going back to what I was saying earlier, they take this break from each other and they come back in the studio. They could have come back as like very, very not on the same wavelength anymore, but it seems, you know, I mean, I wasn't there obviously, but it seems that they all managed to stay on the same wavelength, or they all went on to this new wavelength together. It's perhaps more accurate. Just a little curio, because we did a show about 1966. Amazingly, at the same time that they were recording this, and this shows the progression that we talked about earlier, they were mixing, I think it was the Oldies and Goldies album. Have you ever heard that one?
Oh, yeah, it was one of those cheapo thing where they just stuck loads of different tracks, yeah.
Yeah, well, they brought it out Christmas 66, because obviously they didn't have any material. They didn't have a Christmas single or Christmas album. But I love this image of, like, they were obviously mixing it in another studio. You can imagine the Beatles have been doing Strawberry Fields. They're into this sort of whole other world. And then in the next studio, you know, they might be walking past and they hear She Loves You and it's being mixed. And they're thinking, who were those people who made that song? I mean, that, you know, again, 3 years from I Wanna Hold Your Hand to Strawberry Fields. I don't know what else to say, to be honest. Let's move on before I wax lyrical too much.
My next track is I Am the Walrus. And we have been talking about nonsense lyrics, so especially in What's New, Mary Jane. It does feel to me that in terms of those, what you could call nonsense lyrics, I mean, I don't know how much time John spent on these lyrics, but they do seem to have much more dense thickets of imagery. And if you do dissect the track line by line, and sometimes it's hard to know how much credence you give to that, there's lots of reference points in relation to John's story or conversations other people have had about him and can equate it to certain lines. And also as a production, again, very ambitious. Lots going on for the ears, a feast of sound and imagery, I would say. Perhaps not the best Beatles track or John Lennon track, but it's certainly up there for me.
While you were talking, I was thinking this would be, I'm sure, top 10. But I think the lyrics, I interviewed Rod Davis, who was in The Quarrymen, who was actually the first guest I had on my show. And he was saying that he remembered that a lot of the lyrics came from a song they used to sing at Quarrybank School, like Yellow Matter Custard, Green Slot Pie, or something like that. Very similar. And Rod Davis was saying that he thinks that because of John Lennon's mystique, sometimes that is a bit overplayed in terms of depth.
Maybe John Lennon has been a bit overanalyzed over the years. Maybe, do you think the truth was maybe a bit simpler than people think? Or?
Well, an awful lot of Beatles stuff has been overanalyzed.
Right, yeah.
Especially lyrics.
Yes.
So maybe the answer is a little bit simpler. I mean, one of Pete Shotton's stories was that he was around at John's house one day, not when the Beatles were famous, and John was in the process of writing I'm the Walrus. There were all these sacks in John's front hall, and I asked him what they were. He said, oh, they're fan letters. Are you going to bother answering them then? Says Pete, no, I'm not going to bother, says John, because there'll be another five sacks full tomorrow and the next day. I just throw them away. Cut the long story short. John said to me, look, you can have a look at them if you wish, you know. So anyway, he said he found a letter from a lad from Quarry Bank who'd been asked to interpret John's lyrics. And John said, look, they are. I told them I was a genius at school and they didn't believe me. And now they're setting my lyrics in English classes. He said to Pete, what was that song we used to sing in the playground about custard and dogs? Pete said, Yellow Matter Custard, Grease Slop Pie.
Yeah.
All mixed up with a dead dog's eye, spread it on a sarnie nice and thick and wash it down with a cup of cold sick. And as he was writing I Am a Walrus, he wrote that into the lyrics and he said, let the bastard work out what that means. You know, basically, a lot of the stuff that he wrote was not as deep as people have subsequently researched, you know.
I mean, there are lines like sitting on a cornflake. It's hard to say that that could have too many deep meanings, but that's only one line. You're absolutely right. I mean, the overall effect of it is wonderful. And all that stuff about, man, you've been a naughty boy, you let your face grow long, you let your knickers down. I mean, the overall effect of it is fantastic, but, like, perhaps I'd put it just slightly behind Strawberry Fields or something. But, I mean, there's some great stuff, like the beginning, that da-na-na-na, he was tripping on LSD and he heard a police siren outside his house going da-da-da-da-da-da, and it's just, what a genius idea. I mean, it's just so simple. It's like, why didn't I think of that, you know? But I didn't, you know, and he did. And see how they fly like Lucy in the Sky, you know, he's referencing back to his own lyrics. So why do these nonsense lyrics work and why do the other ones not? Is it just the overall effect? Or?
I'd say so, but I think, so for example, you're given the Yellow Matter Custard example, but actually the notion of childhood image, Alice in Wonderland, is deeply ingrained to English psychedelia, that childlike imagery, and going back to stories and almost freeing yourself from adult constraints. So although it takes a segment of a song that he sung as a child in the playground, actually works on a much deeper level in the context of that song.
It's very good, yeah. Because you're right, because the American psychedelia scene wasn't really like that, was it? It was a bit more grown up. But yeah, you know, Sid Barrett, Pink Floyd, that comes to mind. It's a sort of regression. You're right, escaping the adult world, yeah. And of course, you know, you got the famous, I am he, as you are me, and we are all together. Quite ironic in a way, because John Lennon had really retreated at that time. I mean, he went to the studio when they needed him. If he hadn't got the phone call from Paul or Brian Epstein while he was alive, I don't know how much work he would have done. So it's quite ironic almost. I think I'm going to ask you later towards the end about what John Lennon might have done. And he may well have spent a lot of time on social media, because he could tweet something to the whole world from the safety. You know, you can imagine him in his bed, a bit like what we hear about Trump under the covers. Can you imagine John Lennon tweeting something like that? Because he wouldn't have to leave his house. He had that funny mixture of laziness and dynamism, you know.
One of the people I've talked to on the podcast is Ken Scott, and Ken Scott being a young engineer in that time, and he describes the moment Jeff was on the radio tuning in, and then you've got the whole King Lear reference, which is just even better. Because that went on the mono mix, which was kind of the mix that they focused their energies, but they just couldn't recreate that magic where they're turning the dial on the radio and getting anything. So those sort of moments lift the track even more.
I also read you were there for the mixing of I'm the Walrus and for the famous radio tuning stuff.
Right, King Lear on third programme, which, because we did that live as we mixed and we were mixing to mono, when it came time for the stereo, Jeff Emmerich did the stereo mix of it. And so what they had to do, they could never emulate what occurred with the radio at the end there. And so he had to take the mono mix and just make a sort of fake stereo. And they cut on, Sitting in an English Garden. And that's where it turns to mono. Fake stereo, let me say that.
And then you got the bit, I mean, just the line, I'm crying. They actually recorded this just after Brian Epstein died. So when he sings, I'm crying, you know, it seems real somehow. But the King Lear, I mean, I don't know how much of a fan of Shakespeare you are, but again, I have to credit the Beatles. You know, I did a bit at school and quite liked it. But those lines, I mean, we've talked about this on my show before. Those lines are much more associated with I Am the Walrus than with King Lear, you know, serviceable villain. Sit you down, father, rest you. You know, it's just, in a way, it almost would have been cleverer if they'd planned it. But from all accounts, they didn't, did they?
No.
It could have been another scene from King Lear, but I know thee well, a serviceable villain. You know, what a genius idea. Again, you know, as with Strawberry Fields, though, you have to give George Martin huge credit, because I think it's fairly well established that John didn't really contribute to those scores.
No.
At all, did he?
No, I don't think he had the attention to detail at times. I mean, sometimes he had a wacky idea and put it out there and it was about bringing it to life. But I think at times in relation to this, it was a case of people rising to the challenge of the core material that he presented and building on that, rather than a Brian Wilson type figure.
Absolutely, yeah. I think he was a bit unfair in later years. You know, the Lennon Remembers interview saying, oh, let's hear some of George Martin's music. Those scores are wonderful, you know, and all that. I don't know who came up with it. Everybody's got one, you know. Oompa Oompa, Stick It Up Your Jumper is something I heard when I was a kid. I don't know where. Do you know where that comes from?
It's sort of a game, isn't it? But again, it's that childhood aspect of psychedelia again. But he mixes it with, you know, Semolina Pilchard. So you've got that childhood, but then you've got the Pilchard reference, which is Sergeant Pilchard, that corrupt policeman who basically tried to bust rock stars to bring them down. So it mixes those different vignettes with childhood. It's perfect psychedelia.
Yeah. It just gets better the more you hear it as well. You know, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, I don't necessarily listen to Beatles music that often because terrible cliche, but it's all in my head already. You know, I know the song so well. So when you do hear it after a while, I mean, it just sounds fantastic. You know, Strawberry Fields, Day in the Life, I Am the Walrus.
And now we're going to play a track from Magical Mystery Tour, which is one of my favourite albums because it was so weird. And it's I Am the Walrus. It's also one of my favourite tracks because I did it, of course, but also because it's one of those that has enough little biddies going to keep you interested even 100 years later.
I'm crying. I'm crying. I'm crying. I'm crying. Yellow matter custard. Dripping from a dead dog's eye. Grab a lock of fishwife, pornographic priestess. Boy, you've been a naughty girl, you let your knickers down. I am the Eggman. They are the Eggmen. I am the Walrus. Goo-goo-ga-joob.
Would you have this quite high up your list of best Beatles songs as well?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's up there. In fact, the more we talk about it, the higher it seems to get.
Yeah, it's funny, isn't it? Yeah. If we keep talking about it, it might become our favourite.
It might.
All right. Well, I'm going to go next. So my third one on my top five best. So I'm going one album forward to the White Album, and this is Yeah Blues. My other contender, my honourable mention, was Cold Turkey, because I think they're doing a similar thing, which is this remarkable starkness. It's as much of a nightmare as Strawberry Fields, Yeah Blues, but now he's changed it to this sort of, I think it was described as gut bucket blues in one book, and I can't think of a better explanation. But I chose Yeah Blues over Cold Turkey because just sort of the variations. Cold Turkey's a bit sort of one note, which is perfect for what it does, but Yeah Blues has got like different time signatures. And John Lennon is so quotable. He said, you know, written in India, trying to find God and feeling suicidal. And I think there was a, this is something we've talked about a lot as well on the show, is this thing about when he was in India, he was withdrawing, basically. You know, I think they smuggled a bit of pot and maybe a bottle of whiskey in there or something, but essentially he was more or less drug free for the first time in years, and they were sort of coming down from Beatlemania and trying to process this mad 5 years. You know, they probably never really took a breath. Someone like John Lennon withdrawing from everything, he's going to go through a period where he probably feels like death, you know. But then it's sort of combined this sort of tongue-in-cheek, because I wouldn't really call it a blues song. I don't know if you're a fan of blues music, but when I hear those sort of lyrics, you know, I lost my woman and all that, I can't take it too seriously. I used to have a friend who was into blues, and we used to joke, because he was a sort of white middle-class guy working in an office. Nothing wrong with that at all, but I'm just saying he used to play blues songs and sort of affect American accent, and he'd play them at an open mic. And I remember one exchange we had, which he thought was quite funny. He was singing, like, I lost my woman. And I said, you know, you haven't lost your woman. She's at home ironing your shirts for work in the morning, you know. I don't always find pure blues too authentic. But this Yeah Blues and Cold Turkey, I mean, they're just so authentic, you know. And in the voice, you know, when he sings, just like Dylan's, at Dylan's, Mr. Jones, you know, which is obviously a reference to Ballad of a Thin Man. It's just so, I don't know, gut bucket, you know. And then the way they, you know, the way they recorded it, they recorded it in this sort of annex, basically. It was like a cupboard that had just enough space for the equipment in it, and they did it more or less live. So huge favorite. And all the stuff about, like, the last verse is like a guide vocal, you know, just another idea, you know, just so teeming with ideas. How does this stack up for you, like, in the White Album?
It's a great track, and it's a great moment where the Beatles just got together and played and kind of back to the roots. I think for me it'd be one of the better songs, but not the best. There's a bit of a differing views on that period of the White Album. When I spoke to Jeff Emmerich, he described a tense atmosphere and left, ultimately, to go and rebuild Magic Alex's studio, if you want to call it a studio.
What happened on the White Album, I'd recorded about 10 tracks, and because it wasn't, as far as I was concerned, a very nice atmosphere in the studio, let's just say that. I mean, I decided to leave. But what happened, you know, that I was working with Paul in number two studio, and John might be in number three studio working with someone else, and then, you know, George might be in another studio working with someone else. So they were gradually sort of splitting up, you know.
You left EMI to become Apple Studio Manager. I guess the tension's there.
I tried to shut that out because I went to Apple to rebuild the Magic Alex's studio, which was not really functioning. So we gutted all that out, and it took 2 years to build a new studio in the meantime, although we were also recording the Abbey Road album. So it took 2 years to build that studio, and another 2 years it worked as a commercial studio because they'd built their own little studios in their homes, you know.
Without Brian Epstein at the helm, the group were beset by the additional pressures of business, so much so that even the recording studio, usually a creative refuge for them, stretched their tolerance to breaking point. As tempers frayed, Ringo Starr quit the Beatles, albeit temporarily, during the sessions for what was to become the Double White album. Their recording engineer, Jeff Emmerich.
Things were getting very tense in the studio. And they were arguing amongst themselves, and I left for a while, halfway through. And I went down into the studio and said, you know, I can't take all this arguing, really, amongst yourselves. And then John said to me, he said, well, look, you know, it's basically, you know, this environment, we're so closed in with this that it's adding to our problems and pressures. They really wanted to get out of the studio. This was the problem. They were just locked in there, and they knew they couldn't get out. They probably couldn't see the light at the end of the tunnel. They were halfway through the White Album, probably just a third into it. And I just couldn't mentally take the strain of seeing them argue amongst themselves down in the studio. Looking back, you know, I can be sympathetic to be locked in that awful-looking studio where I'd get a little bit humorous about it. Even to bring a coloured light, you know, to brighten the place up in was a big deal. I mean, we had these terrible white enamelled globe things used to hang from the ceiling with cobwebs on, and I believe John or someone said, well, at least can you just bring a coloured light in, so just let us look at a coloured light instead of white light all day and night. And again, there was a big production number, and they walked in with a red fluorescent tube and put it on this huge stand, and I believe that's still there today at Abbey Road, and just switched it on, and at least to see a red fluorescent tube glowing in the studio was uplifting and calming for a while, you know. It was incredible that you couldn't get a coloured light in the studio, you know. At the time of leaving, it was, to me, the album was impossible to mix. It needed a fresh mind to come in and actually have a clear mind to be able to sit there probably for 3 days and just listen to it to sort out what could be done with it, basically. And it was just messy recording. You know, they deliberately play where they weren't supposed to play and things like that, generally to make the job harder than it really was. I mean, it was getting that bad.
But actually, I've spoken to Ken Scott and I've actually done a separate QA specifically on the White Album, and he basically says that's a load of rubbish. The time that he spent with them actually was a very creative period where they were working individually and then got together. There was, you know, certainly darker moments, but I think I found a quote, yeah, we had a blast, it was a lot of fun with just a couple of darker moments. So that's Ken Scott's recollection of that time, and for me that's probably on balance nearer the truth.
They were taking more control of their own songs. It was more solo-ish. But with regard to sort of all the stories of the acrimony and all of that kind of thing that supposedly went on during that recording, it's utter rubbish. Once again, when doing the book, I wanted to make sure I wasn't remembering it through rose-coloured glasses. So I went to Chris Thomas, who was George Martin's assistant during the album, and John Smith, who was my second engineer for most of the project, and I said, what do you remember about doing the album? And they said, it was a blast. We had so much fun. And the thing is, I've done two-week projects. That's what most, so many of the albums back in the day were. We got 2 weeks to record the album. And at one point or another during the 2 weeks, the artistic temperament comes up and someone gets mad. Now, if it happens during a 2 week project, a 6 month project like the White Album is going to happen more than once. And that's all it was. It was that artistic temperament. I want it my way, and that's how it's going to be. It was that kind of thing. It wasn't them obliterating each other because they hated each other. Ringo left because he didn't think that they appreciated him, and that started him doubting his own talent. that started them all along the same lines. Well, I'm not appreciated, so maybe I should leave. And then finally, once they all got to talk about it properly, they realized how important each one was to each other, that the four of them were a team. It was an amazing team. And after that, when Ringo came back and George had filled the entire studio with flowers to welcome him back, they were as tight as they had been right at the very beginning. They were doing nothing but playing all together. There was so much live stuff that was going on in the studio. It was incredible to watch. It was amazing.
Yeah. Giles Martin, when he did the 50th anniversary, he kind of says that if you listen to the tapes, it sounds like they're having a good time. Yes, but when the tapes start rolling, they're going to be somewhat on. They're not going to have too much sort of dirty laundry on the tapes. You know what I mean?
Mm.
Since we have a clip of Ken Scott, he's actually talking about Cold Turkey, which was my sort of honourable mention.
You left EMI Studios, I think, pretty soon after that period, I think because of the top brass there, and you went over to Trident, but you carried on working with at least three of the Beatles.
Yes, I did some work with John. I mixed Give Peace a Chance there. That was one of the first things I did at Trident. Then I recorded Cold Turkey, which was eventually mixed by Phil McDonald over at Abbey Road.
Was Eric Clapton on that one?
He was indeed.
And that was John's quite sort of primal therapy, aggressive period.
That's my understanding, yeah. It certainly seemed like that in the studio.
Is it quite tense?
Not tense, but just, well, you can tell by the ending of the record. He wanted to put something across, and it was as dirty as it could possibly be, sound-wise. Mm. And just vocally intense, yes.
It's a good segue, actually, with Clapton, because I forgot to mention that Yeah Blues is a brilliant version on the Rock and Roll Circus. I mean, I love that clip. It's John Lennon, obviously, rhythm guitar, vocals, and Eric on lead guitar, just doing these awesome licks. Mm. At least three of the four of them, Keith Richards, three of the four of them were probably all doing heroin at that time, or certainly in the grip of hard drugs. And then Mitch Mitchell on drums, who's a big favourite of mine. I think he's a great drummer. But that version, I'll put a link to that. I think I'm going to probably have about 20 or 30 links, but that's a big favourite. As regards heroin as a subject matter, of course, there's been a lot of songs about that. And, I mean, I'm a big fan of Neil Young, but if you listen to The Needle and the Damage Done next to Cold Turkey, it's a little bit laughable in how sort of genteel it is. You know, and I'm a huge Neil Young fan. I think he's great. You know, you got the Velvet Underground did heroin, did the song Heroin. Golden Brown, you know, There She Goes by the Lars. You know, it's quite a good subject matter, but... All right, as much as I would like to talk for hours and hours, let's go to your next one. So we got two left each. So what's your next one?
My next one is Jealous Guy.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously we're getting into prime Lennon. Although it does bridge that gap with the Beatles, because the original version was written in India, Child of Nature, the original lyrics, which in a way were similar to Mother Nature's Son.
It is well known that the Beatles, particularly George Harrison, were drawn to the mystic teaching of the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, following him first to Bangor in Wales, then to Rishikesh in India. The Beatles, led by Harrison, took Indian instruments and used their unusual non-Western sounds as layers in their recordings, mainly the sitar, the violin-like dilruba, the tabla drum, the four-stringed tanpura. But their interaction with Indian music wasn't just musical tourism. It was to have an effect on their writing that went far beyond the occasional use of sitar and tabla for a bit of exotic colour.
Here's a song originally written while the Beatles were on retreat in Rishikesh. It was called then Child of Nature. On the road to Rishikesh, I was dreaming more or less, and the dream I had was true. Yes, the dream I had was true. I'm just a child of nature. I don't need much to set me free. I'm just a child of nature. I'm one of nature's children. This John Lennon song resurfaced many years later on the Imagine album as Jealous Guy, complete with piano, guitar and strings, sounding just like a regular Western pop song. But its melodic shape gives away its true origin. Before the Maharishi period, John Lennon's tunes tended to be quite static, allowing the movement of the chords underneath the melody to give them their character and their interest. The opening of A Hard Day's Night, for example, has quite a simple static tune with interesting chord changes beneath it. It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. But as his competitive partnership with McCartney developed, John Lennon's tunes became more adventurous, and around the time of his encounter with both Indian culture and hallucinogenic drugs, his tunes acquire a distinctly pentatonic feel. Pentatonic scales are, bluntly, the ones that use just the black notes on a piano. Pentatonic music sounds oriental because it's so prevalent in Asian and Far Eastern music. The Bhupali rag in Indian classical music is pentatonic. Apart from two tiny ornamental notes, the whole Jealous Guy tune can be played on the black notes of a piano. It is completely pentatonic.
The shaping of the melody was one of the many ways that the Beatles responded creatively to Indian music. By fusing Western and Eastern idioms, the Beatles anticipated by 30 years the musical phenomenon of Bhangra that was to sweep through the popular mainstream. But it wasn't just their ability to absorb disparate influences that made them tower over the century. They transformed the whole environment in which music is made. What they got up to in the studio in the 1960s has shaped how people make music ever since.
You got that brilliant melody, but then lyrically you've got the benefit of John Lennon's honesty, which came later, you know, after the primal period or around the primal period. So you've got that prime Beatles melody, as I was saying, but actually you've got the great Lennon honesty and the window into his soul. And you know, we were talking before about the sort of misogynist side of Lennon in a way, and I think this kind of does it, bring a much subtler way.
Yeah,
and I think it's just done much better.
Yeah, wonderful piano by Nicky Hopkins. I mean, the song's wonderful, the singing and the whistling. But then you've got Nicky Hopkins, I think, was a big contribution to that song.
Yeah, I mean, we'll be playing a clip of when I spoke to Joey Molland, known for his time in Badfinger, but you've got that moment where he was asked to come on down.
I understand you went to the Imagine sessions.
Yeah, they called us one day. They called our house, Joe, I think his name was. He was John's driver. And so he asked if we would come down to the house that night. He said they'd send the car for us if we'd come down and bring our guitars with us and play some guitar. John was recording them. Well, of course, we said, yeah, didn't we? You know, a car came 8 o'clock or something that night. Tommy and I were the only ones at the house. Took us down to the mansion, Fitness Park. And we went in. There was nobody there. We couldn't find anybody. And eventually we did find them.
Yeah.
The studio in the back, and Nicky Hopkins, all the lads were there, Klaus Voorman, Jim Keltner. It was great. And George Harrison was there, of course, and Phil Spector. Wow. And then John came in, and we'd never met John. Yeah. I've never met him anyway. I thought he was fantastic. I mean, I was a big, big fan, you know. So it was a real thrill to see him come in the room, and he was all cool, you know. John Lennon with his blue jeans and his shirt and all that, he looked good. He just was real plain as the nose on your face, just dead straight, dead normal. It was really cool. Told us we were going to do a couple of new songs that night, and this first one was going to be Jealous Guy, and it goes like this.
Wow.
And he just played it for us. He put his headphones on, like, and we were sitting about 3 feet, 4 feet away from him, you know, behind a couple of little screens, just to sit there with your headphones on and watch John Lennon sing the song, you know, no matter what song it was. Like, it was astounding for me. It was stunning. We learned it quick. Somebody had the idea about the da-da-da, you know, that funny little chord in there. It was like a minor ninth or something like that. We played it through maybe once or twice, and we recorded it. No, he said what he needed to the musicians. You know, don't screw with the beat. Nicky, can you come up with a beginning, with an intro, you know? Because Klaus was just cool and just made his bass pick up and didn't say anything, you know? So it was just great.
But actually, the interesting thing about that clip is that even then, he was getting ideas from the band members in different parts of the song, that collaboration that lifted things. And obviously, he would have got some of that from Nicky Hopkins as well.
Mm.
John Lennon never pretended that he was the same caliber as the musicians, technically, did he?
No.
You know, he was never going to pretend, oh, I can play this piano. He knew that Nicky Hopkins could play technically better. Obviously, John was fine for what he did. But some of those piano embellishments on the Imagine album, like How, is a big favourite. That was one of my bubbling under songs. Again, like amazing honesty, you know. Life can be long, but you've got to be so strong. The world, she's tough. Sometimes I feel like I've had enough. Wonderful. We've done some reviews of a couple of Imagine films. There's actually four films connected with this project. Have you seen like the weird one, which is all the music videos?
No.
It's actually on YouTube. We did a review of it recently. It's just amazingly surreal. How Do You Sleep is basically a pool game where they don't put any of the balls, and then all these balls keep appearing, and by the end of the video, the table's just full of balls. We surmise that that was a metaphor for life's problems, that they just keep mounting, and you can never get the balls in the pockets, you know, you can never put the problems to bed. And then it's got they're playing chess, and he's putting pieces in his mouth. And the big gag with that is that they're both playing white. There's no white and black, so obviously no one's going to win. There's some hidden meanings in there. And then you've got the sort of Imagine 88 film, which we reviewed recently. Yeah, but there's this bizarre video where it's a sort of aerial shot of Tittenhurst Park, which is obviously this incredibly 70, 80 acres, something like that. And then there's like a hearse. You see this hearse driving past. I can't remember whether John Yoker could get in the hearse or out the hearse. I can't remember, but there's these wonderfully bizarre videos that have really got nothing to do with the songs. But that's a great song. Or just play your other Joey Mullen clip, actually, which is about I Don't Want to Be a Soldier. It's one of those mood pieces, but I love it. That's got King Curtis as well. Very Plastic Ono in that it's very minimalist, and it's quite progressive because it hasn't got a lot of lyrics. So we'll play that now.
And we stayed around. We played Jealous Guy first. And then John said, well, that was great, lads, and then really good. He said, you bad figure, lads, for fuck off, that's the like. You know, he wasn't throwing us out. He was just telling us if we wanted, we could split. You know, like we'd be bored at a John Lennon recording session, you know. And we chose to stay anyway, and we kept our guitars on. And he said, I don't know, this is a song that Don't Want to Be a Soldier. And he started playing it. He said, I don't really know what the beat is or anything, but it kind of goes, you know, like this. And he played it. It had some weird kind of turnarounds in it where they drop a beat here and there or grab another beat from another bar or something. You know, that was about as best as he could explain what he was talking about. And of course, he just played it for us, and we all kind of jammed along with it, really. And I guess it all worked out, and he recorded it. We only did maybe two or three takes of that. What was funny about it, when the Imagine album came out, that was the one he gave us credit for, not Jealous Guy.
So, my penultimate one, my last two are in fact from the same album, because we recently did a show about 1970, and I listened back to the Plastic Ono album, and I was just completely blown away, because I hadn't listened to it for a long time, even though I knew the song. So, Oh My Love was a contender, but I've gone for Love. As we were saying earlier, the difference in Plastic Ono and Imagine, I love both albums. If you compare Love with Oh My Love, Love is just, it's more stark. It's got this very haunting vocal. You know, it's clearly was treated, you know, John Lennon always liked his vocals to be treated. But, you know, we're talking earlier about simple lyrics, you know, love is real, real is love. And it's got all this amazing stuff. Love is wanting to be loved. Love is asking to be loved. Love is needing to be loved. It just works. I mean, I just can't explain it. It's just nearly brings me to tears sometimes listening to that song. It's used on a lot of documentaries about him, and it seems like whatever images it's matched with, it just seems to have such a powerful effect.
I've had probably the most wonderful, wonderful experiences and had probably the worst tragedies. I feel being here is it's really spooky, very spooky. Free is love. for one reason or another, it's been my fate to meet a man that has become a legend, to have his son. What has happened since, you know, has sort of wiped away all these memories for many years, and I'm suddenly back here again. Of course I love him. Of course I love him. I love John as I loved him. You don't change love. There's no reason on earth why I should hate him. And it's sad. It's full of ghosts.
I don't really know what else to say. I feel like the song just kind of speaks for itself. What do you think?
Do you think it's the Yoko influence in this period? Because obviously Imagine, in a way, was a bit of a co-write, but she got that knack of very simple statements. So it'd be interesting to see the Yoko influence in relation to love, because I don't know the actual background behind that, but it feels to me that there is a strong Yoko influence.
Oh, I mean, with Yoko, I would say I probably prefer her influence to her execution, let's say. You know, I mean, she brought out Plastic on her band album, which is a tough listen, but the ideas on it and some classic moments on it, you know, all that stuff about she sort of predated the B-52s by about 10 years, you know, with the screaming. But I think for sure, you know, as you said, Imagine, a lot of it came from her book Grapefruit, which is a really cool book. It's not like sitting down to read a novel. It's images, you know, it's ideas. It's amazing stuff. And you know all that stuff about when he was in India and she'd send him a postcard that just said, oh, look in the sky for a cloud, that's me. And what you were saying earlier about the psychedelia being about childhood, I think it was Victor Spinetti who was in some of the Beatles films. He said her appeal was that she allowed him to be like a child, in the sense of having no filter and simplifying, as you said, simplifying things down.
It's a great playmate. Imagine somebody that comes to you and says, here's a blank wall, here's a box of crayons, let's draw on it. That goes back to plasticine modelling as a kid. That's irresistible. Yes, very interested. Love to know about things. How did this work? What has happened here? I mean, not a dull man.
So she had an enormous influence on this guy, you know. Yeah, some of it's self-indulgent. You know, her screaming is a bit difficult to take, but she's a true artist. I mean, she was an artist before she met him, you know. She wasn't that famous, okay, but she was known. And you know, that whole album, I mean, his vocals on it, it's partly him, of course, and it's partly the production. And the point I was going to make earlier, I don't know how much Phil Spector, I don't know if Phil Spector had a more minimalist side to him that we don't know about, but if you compare this to All Things Must Pass, I mean, you can't believe it's the same person.
I love All Things Must Pass, but it has parts of it, the production is just way too heavy.
Mm-hmm.
I get the feeling that Spector was almost checking out on this. My assumption is that he was there kind of in name. It's not really a Spector thing, but all for the better.
I think officially it's John Yoko and Phil for this and Imagine, I'm pretty sure. So I think you're right. Of course, Phil Spector played the piano on this song, so kudos for that.
Yeah,
it's a lovely piano. I didn't even know he played the piano, but the way it sort of fades in and fades out, I mean, it's just amazing. And I think what he contributed, this sort of primal rock, if you want to call it, you know, he said Strawberry Fields was psychoanalysis set to music. That was a famous quote. This is primal therapy set to music, and it's just staggering. Right, your last one.
Yeah, so I thought I'd pick something from his final period, really, just to provide a bit of a cross-section there. So I've chosen I'm Losing You.
Very good.
We talked a lot about Yoko on this and John's insecurities or jealousies and all that kind of thing, and this ties in with that again. But some great imagery here in a stranger's room, etc. You've got a real vulnerability there, got that honesty again. You've almost got that sort of that gut element you were talking about there with Yeah Blues, and it combines all that together. And we were also talking about different versions. Well, there's obviously two famous versions of this. You've got the original released version, which is great, but you've also got the Cheap Trick version, the real heavy version, and I think they both work in different ways. So for me, it's almost twice as good because you've got two really great versions of that song that both work in their own realm.
Couldn't agree more, yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't make a distinction between the two. They're both great. There's some great demos. The song was originally called Stranger's Room, and it's just him with a piano, and he sounds very lonely. In fact, the original lyric is, here in this lonely room, then it becomes here in this stranger's room.
Here in this lonely room, late in the afternoon, dreaming my life away. Don't answer the
never heard this bootleg called Between the Lines. I mean, it's a bit long. It's about six CDs. It's lots of different versions of the same songs, but maybe I'll send you the highlights or something.
I don't know if I've got that bootleg, but I've heard many of the bootlegs. I've probably got a condensed version of that where you've got many songs that morphed into other ones or were merged or that kind of thing.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. As I was saying earlier, I sounded like I was attacking him a bit when I said he sort of told this Porky Pie about having his guitar hung up. But I think, you know, the famous story of he was in Bermuda and he describes having a sort of diarrhea of creativity, which is another, you can't ever say John Lennon wasn't full of quotable lines. Again, it's a sort of half-truth because he was inspired and he did write a few. But ironically, the truth in many ways is the total opposite in that he crafted these songs for a year or two in some cases. Yeah. The one they released, you know, The Real Love.
Yes.
I really like Free as a Bird. That kind of grew on me, but Real Love never quite grew on me, the Beatles version. But at the end of one of his demos of Real Love, he starts singing, if it don't feel right, don't do it, which ended up on, oh dear, help me with this. If it don't feel right, don't do it. Not Borrowed Time, it's the other one. Stepping Out.
Ah, yeah.
That one sounded quite finished, actually, that ended up on this Milk and Honey posthumous thing. We have a clip, don't we, of Earl Slick?
Yeah, so I had the pleasure of talking to sideman for hire Earl Slick, who played on those sessions, Double Fantasy and what became Milk and Honey, and we've got him talking about Jack Douglas basically getting along, but at the start not knowing necessarily who it was for and then working it out. And then I think he also talks about the sound on guitar that he got him and Hugh McCracken, and they were the guitarists on that track.
You then worked with John Lennon. Understand that was through Jack Douglas, David's producer?
It was a weird situation because I found out, I guess after we'd been in the studio for a week or two, that it actually came from John.
Right.
Because he remembered us working together. And the rest of the guys in the band were really the top-of-the-line session players. Hugh McCracken on guitar. He was great, Huey. And Tony Levin and Andy Newmark and so on. And those guys could read charts, but they could still play, you know, they didn't sound like sterile session musicians, you know, they could still give the music a lot of personality. And he just needed one guy in there that was really just more of a street rock and roll player. So I guess he thought about me when we worked together before, and he had Jack contact me in big secrecy. Jack wouldn't tell us who it was, my manager, and I'm going, well, you got a record for me to do. And you're not telling me who it is, so it can't be Mr. Nobody. It's got to be somebody that doesn't want this leaking out. So I just picked in my brain. I'm going, okay, who's Jack Workman? Aerosmith, Lennon, this one, that one, Cheap Trick. I'm going, it can't be Cheap Trick. It can't be Aerosmith. And I went through the lineup, and I went, okay, it's got to be Lennon. Because he hasn't recorded anything in a good 5 years. And if Jack wants all this secrecy, so I was right, you know. In one of the next conversations, I kind of just said, look, I mean, I'm dying to know who it is, and I think it's Lennon. And he got really quiet. I said, okay, good. That's my answer. That always works. You throw something out there, and if the guy gets quiet, you got it.
And you feature quite promptly on I'm Losing You. It's got that compressed sound on the guitar.
Isn't that cool? That was John's idea. Ah. Well, me and Huey put that solo together with John. It was a Beatles trick of stacking. This got to be 3 or 4 tracks of me and Huey playing that together, really compressed to get that sound. Really clean, but really compressed. And if you listen to Nowhere Man, you can hear it on there.
One of my kind of bubbling unders was Nobody Told Me. He just sounds so, not world-weary, but worldly. Like, this is a guy who's done it all in 40 years, you know, and when he sings, you know, Strange Days Indeed. I love the bit where he goes, strange days indeed, strange days indeed. He's almost like saying, you know, that I've had the strangest days of anyone else, you know. No one's had stranger days than me, you know. All that stuff about Nazis in the bathroom and the little yellow idol to the north of Kathmandu. Mm. So that was very close.
John's no longer with us, but there was the Milk and Honey album. With the music there largely completed while he was alive.
Yeah, what happened with that was is that when we went in the studio, we just kept cutting and cutting and cutting.
Right.
You know, the way that things were done then is some fans would just go in there with, you know, 10 songs, that was it.
Yeah.
People like John, though, would record a whole bunch of songs, which was really good because then you could kind of put a record together, especially that kind of a record. It's like a puzzle. And you need all the right pieces to fit in the right spots. And, you know, if you just write 10 songs, you may not have all the pieces. So we cut 2 albums worth of stuff, and then he picked what worked for Double Fantasy. And then what was left over was Milk and Honey, that we were going to go back in the studio at the beginning of 1981, which didn't happen, obviously, and we were going to finish off all the overdubbing on that. So what you hear on Milk and Honey is basically live, all of it. Vocals and everything, obviously, because we didn't really spend a lot of time putting vocals on those, or John didn't.
And to leave off tracks like Nobody Told Me until later, something in kind of how confident you are in the strength of your material?
Absolutely. And the funny thing was, is that was one of the first things we recorded. My memory serves me, I'm pretty sure that Just Like Starting Over was the first one, and somewhere within those first 2 or 3 songs, Nobody Told Me was recorded.
From those sessions, the line that, you know, I listen to quite a few Beatles podcasts, and everyone always quotes this line. You know the song, I Don't Want to Face It?
Yeah.
You say you want to save humanity, but it's people that you just can't stand. I mean, talking about honesty, if people really analyze that, you'd say, well, you were doing all of this stuff for world peace, but you can't stand individual people.
Mm.
But you know what he's saying. He's not saying he hates everyone, but he's just so brilliant at boiling down all the contradictions and all the weird things of life into these little lines. Yeah, genius. Can I give you my last one?
Please.
So we're going back 10 years. We're going back to the same album as before, and I'm going to choose God. The beginning part's got this famous line, God is a concept by which we measure our pain. And I was trying to think of what that meant, and I just looked online for some interpretations, and one quote, this was just from a blogger, I think, this is talking about people using God as a clever device to avoid the hard work of dealing with our internal psychological and emotional battles. So, you know, it's using God as a crutch, you know?
Once he decided that he was going to get off that boat of the Beatles, so to speak, I think he just became very real.
You're born in pain, you know, and pain is what we're in most of the time. And I think that the bigger the pain, the more gods we need, you know?
God is an amazing song. God is a concept by which we measure our pain. Is, you know, it's a very profound thought.
He rented a house in Bel Air, which is a very ritzy area here. And we talked about things, and he said, what about God? And I would go on and on about, you know, people who have deep pain generally tend to believe in God with a fervency and blah, blah. And, oh, he said, oh, you mean God is a concept by which we measure our pain? You know, it just bang. and I'd go all around it, and he would just like that. And that was John. I mean, John could take very profound philosophic concepts and make it simple.
It's very clever musically, because it's basically using four chords, and it's the same four chords that you would find in Stand By Me. They call it the doo-wop sequence. So in the key of G would be G, E minor, C and D. So he takes those four chords and creates something that's as far from, you know, Please Mr. Postman as you could possibly get. So it's got this first section, and then he's got obviously the I Don't Believe In All These Things, ending with, you know, Elvis, then Zimmerman, which is Dylan, and then Beatles. Again, very brave, you know. And then suddenly he sounds like a child. And just believe in me. You know, he sounds like a vulnerable child.
God's Song, a critic said, some of the finest of all rock singing on the last verse. Where I got that from? I got it written down.
Who is this wonderful
Thank you very
critic?
Much.
Where is he when we need him?
I know.
I want to send him a card.
I've been wending my way through some notes, and that particular quote happened to come out.
You tend to remember the dig from a critic rather than the praise, you see. That's why I'm looking at you like, oh, somebody liked it. I had this impression that everybody hated the record, and it was only regarded well about 8 years later when they'd started saying, well, it's not as good as Plastic Ono Band, about the work I was doing later, you see.
The same voice as, you know, the song Isolation, you know, just a boy and a little girl trying to change the whole wide world. Just incredibly stark. And then he says, you know, I was the dream weaver, but now I'm reborn. I was the walrus, now I'm John. And so, dear friends, we just have to carry on. The dream is over. Musically, it's got two pianos. So that kind of pounding piano is John. It's called a tack piano, which is a sort of slightly honky-tonk piano. And then the sort of licks in between the I Don't Believe In, that's all Billy Preston.
He was on Let It Be, and they got on real well. And Billy loved the band, and they loved Billy. John actually said, come on, Billy, do a little of your gospel piano. It's about God, you know. So he inspired him to do something that's his upbringing. Billy learned piano playing and organ playing in church. He really believed in God, and that's the way he plays on this song. It's beautiful.
It's interesting just hearing the two sounds of the pianos, actually. I mean, one is a normal classical piano, a Steinway piano, which Billy Preston played. And then we've got the honky-tonk piano, which is a simpler playing, just a rhythm piano, which is what John played. It's both Steinway pianos, but just a totally different sound. I'll just sell out the drums here, just to give you... Just interesting just hearing these... And the fact that each one of these Tom Fills, are all different.
I've never done a fill the same twice. Because when I do it, it's where I'm at that moment, you know. And so if you want to then re-record that track, I'll do a fill in that space, but it won't be the same. You know, my way of drumming, yeah, I can keep time. But when the fill, which I always feel is my art, it has to do with the surrounding atmosphere at that moment.
So it's got this amazing juxtaposition of all these different things, this sort of primal therapy purging of 60s heroes. It's a message of hope saying, you know, believe in yourself. I mean, I just believe in me could sound amazingly narcissistic, but then he says, Yoko and me, and so, dear friends, we have to carry on. It's that perfect marriage of personal and universal.
Little by little, all of the veils were being pulled away, you know, all of the idolatry, all the people he thought were just incredible. And you realize it just, when all is said and done, you only have yourself. And that's just the truth, you know. And he came to that conclusion very quickly in therapy.
It's like, I no longer believe in myth, you know, and Beatles is another myth.
People really did think the Mop Tops, the Fab Four, were going to last forever.
It was shocking. I don't believe in the Beatles. Said that in print, Rolling Stone, and on that album.
It was a very big thing with John. He was going through a heavy time of finding himself, dispelling, you know, a lot of his childhood and putting into a real space, you know, and searching, like the rest of us, for the meaning. For me, I play drums, okay? And if he wants to search, I'll play with you. You know, that's how it was.
having listened to it today in our discussion, I'm just thinking more and more that Plastic Ono Band could be my contender for like the best album ever. And I am a huge John Lennon fan, obviously. I've got a podcast about him and I talk for hours as we're doing now. But is it positive or negative? It's the end of a dream. Do you think when he name checks all those people, do you think it's about his life or everyone's life? And is he consciously trying to include everyone else in it, do you think?
Yeah, I think it's broader because it's about constructs, isn't it? It's social constructs and the BS around that and what's real and what's real is you and there and the people around you. It's not those figures out there, all the imagery that goes around them. It's about getting to the truth. Give me some truth.
Give me some truth, yeah. I mean, that was a kind of a contender as well. That wasn't far from my list. I think you're absolutely right. One of the tragedies, perhaps, is that he never really played live much as a solo performer. There was the one-to-one concert. He seemed to do a lot of charity concerts. He did a Lou Grade one where he just sung a couple of songs. Mm. He did some political rallies where he sung, you know, John Sinclair, Attica State. I get the impression that the Beatles tours are just put him off that forever. Do you think had he lived, he would have toured again?
Yeah, I think there was the odd moment in the 70s where he almost got back with Paul and that kind of thing. And I think they'd have got together. They might have played some TV special or some limited shows. Mm. I think there's a whole reunion and live thing that would have worked. And, you know, maybe with the live scene as it is now, as opposed to recorded, that maybe Paul might have done, sorry, maybe John might have done some arena-type shows or something. Not like Paul, who was kind of always going for playing live and keeping on playing live, but yeah. I think he certainly would have played. It'd be interesting to see how John would navigate the 1980s, though.
Sound. I just want to make one more point, and then I've got a couple of questions for you, which are kind of related to what we were talking about. I think John Lennon and Marlon Brando are probably the two most fascinating cultural figures for me. Perhaps someone like Orson Welles as well, but probably those two. And I've read a lot about both of them, and they have something in common. Like, just as John Lennon, I can't imagine him ever just being someone just doing tours year after year and just repeating the same stuff. And interestingly, Brando obviously came to stardom with, you know, Streetcar and On the Waterfront in the 50s, but he quit Broadway pretty quickly. And it's almost the same thing, because in the theater, you know, you have to do six to eight performances a week. And he was so creative and such a low boredom threshold, which is very like John Lennon, that when they did Streetcar, he would do almost a different Stanley every night. But there's only so far you can do that. So I think, like John Lennon, he had a lazy streak, but he also had a kind of, this is bullshit, you know, just doing the same songs over and over and over. I don't need it, you know. Mm. And he definitely 100% doesn't need the adulation like perhaps Paul does. I think Paul just likes performing, but I don't see how you can go on stage like Paul every night, get all the adulation almost every day of your life, and remain totally normal. I think Paul does a good job of it, a really good job, actually, but I just can't see that with John Lennon. But there's a lot of talk about this sort of 1975 to 80 period, and there's two books which sort of represent the two opposite extremes, and there's one by Ray Coleman, which is actually the first John Lennon book I ever read. And it's quite innocent. It's kind of, oh, John Lennon did this. He was into drugs. He did cold turkey. But then he stopped taking drugs and he became a family man. It's a very simple version. And then you've got the Albert Goldman version, which is, you know, John Lennon was a wasted heroin addict who probably went to Thailand and frequented, you know, brothels. As far from Ray Coleman, where do you stand on John Lennon in 1980? Do you think he had reached a happy point, or was it the opposite, or somewhere in the middle? Not to put you on the spot.
It'd have been interesting to see his path, because I don't know if him and Yoko would have lasted, or perhaps they would have had time apart again. It'd be interesting to see how that played out. Mm. I'd be surprised as he got older that he would carry on with the junk. And then obviously Sean getting older, etc., recording again. I think, you know, there's that John Lennon song, Life Begins at 40. Mm. And I think it would have marked a new period. Perhaps not a period where he would have had great commercial success, but artistically, there was definitely a lot more to come.
I'm not sure if I could see him surviving to now, being 80, for example. Although I suppose if he might have gone the other way, because he was an obsessive person. You know, I haven't followed Iggy Pop recently, but the last I heard of Iggy Pop, he was some sort of health freak who did like 100 press-ups a day or something. And I could see that the way John Lennon might survive would be to go completely the other way, as he arguably already had with the macrobiotic stuff. But, you know, I've asked a few of my guests, you know, what would John Lennon have done and how long would he have survived? I can imagine him and Yoko probably having, like, some kind of Twitter war and having some sort of social media divorce kind of thing or something like that. But musically, what sort of styles do you think he might have embraced post-1980 if he'd lived?
It's a 50-50 one, isn't there? Because there's kind of a romantic side of Lennon, but then, you know, is there that Cheap Trick side? I mean, it didn't get released. So there's different paths that he could have taken, and it's hard to know which one. I think possibly a bit more of the romantic side, unless he would have flitted between the two a little bit. I don't think it would have been necessarily all harder, but then I'm not sure he would have peddled out, you know, those romantic Yoko yearning albums too much either. So we perhaps had some twists and turns, maybe a bit of both.
Yeah, and another thought that came to me is that maybe as he got older, you know, 50 or whatever, he might have thought that being a rocker was sort of not beneath him, but yeah, he might have got tired of that. He might have become perhaps even a long-form writer.
Mm.
Sure, he was well capable of writing a film script or something.
It's about whether he had the attention.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. But I was just thinking, you know, as he got older, I think those kind of rockers in their 40s, someone like, let's say, Keith Richards or someone, they are still almost like teenagers in that they've never quite had to grow up too much. So I feel like with John Lennon, maybe when he got to 50, got to 60, he might have had a sort of late maturity almost. And it would have been nice to see him knuckle down. And I think I would love to have read a novel written by him, for example.
I think in relation to those artistic projects, it would depend who was around him at the time and who he would collaborate with. There'd probably need to be something or someone to drive him on day after day to keep going. I think there's definitely something else artistically over the music that we've missed out on. And it's hard to know whether that could have been driven by Yoko or actually whether that well of ideas of Yoko was exhausted and actually it might have been someone else.
Regarding his sort of composing abilities, I mean, those demos that we've been talking about, 75 to 80, I don't think there's too many real sort of knockouts.
No.
I mean, Nobody Told Me was written in 75, and that's a knockout for me. But I don't know. I'm not sure he had too many classics in him. How do you think Double Fantasy stacks up with his other solo ones? Where would you put it in, like, a list, let's say?
It's hard to say when it's half an album.
Yeah.
For me, there's some good singles. You know, not quite like Mind Games, but in a way, a bit like Mind Games, there's some great standout moments. So, I think less of the Yoko would have been good.
I think some of Milk and Honey was fairly well fleshed out. I like Borrowed Time, that's a good one. Grow Old With Me is quite nice. I think he almost had an album in 1980. I mean... Yeah. I'd get rid of Forgive Me, My Flower Princess. He did one called Dear John, which is quite nice.
Oh, yeah, I know that.
And he kind of goes, Dear John, don't be hard on yourself. I love that, you know, that sentiment of... I am a songwriter, and I've written a few lyrics which are written to myself. And it's quite a nice thing to do, and you're almost like giving yourself advice in a song. As far as musical styles, I don't think he would have done hip-hop, but I think he would have loved hip-hop, the early hip-hop, you know, the real...
What, Public Enemy? Stuff.
Yeah, I mean, he would love the spirit behind
it. Fight the power.
Yeah. He would have said, I don't think in a condescending way, but he would have said, they're doing what we did in 71.
Yeah.
And I think he would have said, when Nirvana appeared, that's the Beatles in Hamburg. And we know that if you've ever seen the classic albums, that great series, they did one on Nevermind, and Butch Vig said the way that he got Kurt Cobain to double-track his voice was by telling him that John Lennon double-tracked it. And Cobain was a huge John Lennon fan. So... I could see them doing something. I think they would have really identified with each other.
The Outsider. Yeah, I mean, if you look at About a Girl, for example, Nirvana, you're very Beatlesque.
Yeah, I remember when I was learning that, and when Unplugged in New York came out, because I was a guitarist, I bought the sheet music. You know, in the days when you had to buy sheet music. There was a day, youngsters, most of the songs are very easy, which is what's so great about them. And I remember it's in a key of E, and it has a change A to C, which is exactly the same as I saw her standing there. And I remember thinking that. I was thinking, oh, that's quite Beatly, yeah. Final thing, do you think he would have contributed to the anthology? Do you think he would have been up for that?
Yeah. As we know, Paul and John had issues at times, but they loved each other. And I think the excuse to get back together and just be together again would have been too great. And I think to build a wall between, ultimately, brothers, I don't think that that would have lasted, or actually did last, in a way. And I think as Sean got older and the focus on Sean maybe receded a little bit, I think, yeah.
So many what-ifs. I mean, he could have... I'm sure he would have played live with Julian. You know, that would have been a great bonding thing for them, wouldn't it?
Mm.
Probably, as I say, maybe we've agreed that he would have been more one-offs than full tours. You know, he would have played with Sean, I'm sure.
There's a clip from the Once Upon a Time box set where he's just talking to Sean as a toddler.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember listening to that for the first time, you know, 20 years ago or whatever, and it was just heartbreaking. You know, you just got a real sense for him as a loving human.
That's my favorite song.
Very good.
Who was saying, I need some money to love? You?
Ringo, but Paul and I are singing with him.
What's the song, Paul?
What could you think,
what's
it called? I forgot
what it's
would called.
You think if I sang in a song?
Sang out of tune. Oh, A Little Help from My Friends, that's what it's called.
And for someone to cut that so short, and for the impact he had on the rest of the world, was such a loss and so many what-ifs.
Mm. The bridge of Beautiful Boy, where he sings, you know, I can hardly wait to see you come of age, but I guess we both just have to be patient. I mean, if that doesn't bring a tear to your eye, I don't know what will, you know. I was kind of joking about social media. Don't you think that would kind of suited his lazy side?
Just throw out a few missives and... Yeah.
And one of my other guests, we were joking that, you know, like if you put a tweet out or you send an angry email to someone, the problem is you can't delete it. In theory, it's there forever. We were saying, oh, how many times would John Lennon have had to apologize? Like... tweets that he'd thrown out to people when he was in an angry mood or something. Amazing. Right, we have done 2 hours 15. This is bound to be a two-parter. I think I'll put the worst songs in part one and then the best songs in part two.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine.
Yeah. Any conclusions? What do you think were his strongest and his weakest periods? How about that?
Well, I never realised it, talking about certainly some of his strongest material and certain aspects of some of his weaker material. There's a thread and themes going through many of them. You know, at certain points, childhood imagery, the notion of pain, the snatches of vignettes that he brings into different tracks of his, even though certain songs were from different times, you know, because we talked about Girl and there's that line about pain and pleasure.
Yeah.
But actually there's that opening line in God, for example. So talking through these songs here, it's really interesting to see the ongoing themes that were weaved through his material that I hadn't necessarily built up in my mind.
Yeah, I mean, you get a lot from talking to someone else who's really into the subject. It sparks things. Because I made a bunch of notes this morning, but talking to you is really nice that things come up in the moment, isn't it? But I feel like it's become a bit of a cliche, the idea that pain produces great art. But I think in John Lennon's case, it's just absolutely there. Because he was having a terrible time in 66, 67. Mm. You know, a lot of it was self-inflicted. I mean, he probably didn't do 1,000 trips, as he said. But, you know, probably people have said, you know, he was, apart from the times when he was at the studio, he was tripping almost every day for a good few months. I mean, that's going to fry your brain. That's why I don't think he would have survived to the present day. But, you know, he was really having a rough time for a lot of that, and there were various reasons. But, 67, well, 66,
Well, 65.
Maybe 65.
Yeah, 65 to 70. But I think perhaps he peaked, other than Strawberry Fields, Day in the Life and Walrus, I think are up there with anything. But I think as a sustained thing, perhaps I'd go Plastiono. But
how do you agree
apples
with that?
And oranges.
Because I think in 67 there were snatches of genius. Whereas actually there's more consistency in 1970, or volume.
Well, of course, yeah, he had to produce a whole album. That's the other thing, you know. I mean, as far as he says it with the Beatles, Paul would have written a fair few songs already and then called the others and said, let's go to the studio. I don't think it was quite as clear-cut as that, but, you know. And as regards the early stuff, I think, you know, there's stuff like There's a Place. I mean, that's pretty reflective. So there's a kind of logic to his life, even though there were twists and turns. The weakest period, are we thinking sometime in New York City, Mind Games, somewhere around there?
When the 70s got funky and he couldn't do funk, and the political sloganing got a bit clichéd and hackneyed.
Yeah, and then, well, I guess Walls and Bridges, he, as I said, although you had one of the songs on your list, worst list, there are some gems, and the kind of the slower ones from Mind Games, yeah, the Asuma-san, we had Bless You, that was on
Scared.
Walls and Bridges. Scared,
yeah.
Talk about honest. Mm. My God. And then Nobody Loves You with a Down and Out is, you know, he wanted Sinatra to do that. Oh, well, I don't think he actually tried to get Sinatra, but he said that was my Sinatra moment, you know. And then I'd probably say Mind Games when Push Comes to Shove, because I think I like the New York City a bit more than you do, but I get your point.
I think there's enough standout moments in Mind Games to be worth price alone.
Right, right. And it's so different as well. One's overtly political and one's... It's just a little bit middling. I find, like, as you said, it's half a good album. And if you think about it, his solo career isn't actually that many songs.
No.
I mean, 69, he was kind of solo because, you know, we didn't even mention Give Peace a Chance. I mean, it's not the most amazing song, but it's so... There were up to 500,000 people singing that in November 69 around the Washington Monument. Mm. You know, all we're saying is Give Peace a Chance. And there's still people singing it now, you know, because it's so simple and it's so catchy. Yeah,
we haven't mentioned Instant Karma.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's a great song. Great.
That was close to my list, and that's 1970 again.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All right. That was amazing. Thank you very much.
Is that okay?
It was more than okay. The only thing is I'm already having nightmares about editing it. Not because you're not articulate. It's just, you know, editing podcasts is... Depends how sort of OCD perfectionist you are, and I'm afraid I'm quite bad.
Yeah, so, I'm a bit less OCD than I used to be. I've learned to let a few ums and ahs. I do too many ums and ahs, so feel free to go to town if you have the patience. I really don't mind. I don't edit where it's in the flow and it's a, you know, too obvious a chop, but if I'm just going and then there's a gap or I definitely do take it out. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much. This will be a swap cast, so hopefully you'll have this as an episode on your podcast. How long are the episodes in general on yours?
Probably up to 2 hours, but I mean, they're often typically about 90 minutes.
Okay. We're getting on for 2.5 hours. It'll be a two-parter, and I'll put the first part out as the worst. I think I'll put worst in quotes, because I don't really think they were that bad.
No, I don't think so. Much of the choices were just kind of routine. Beatles on autopilot or Lennon on autopilot rather than objectionable. And even some of the ones that I chose were kind of like more irritating. Or there are aspects of it I like and other aspects that I don't, rather than hatred.
Yeah. And just before you go, I want to say thank you for talking me down to doing our top 10. <'Cause>,
what
can
would
you
imagine? 4 hours? It's like four or five parter.
Yeah, well, you know, we just suspend the next 6 months of our life. We can meet every week. And But stay on the line, and we'll just say the official goodbye. So thanks very much, and if we eventually get this edited and everything, maybe we'll talk in the future.
My pleasure, Antony. It's been fantastic to talk to you, and I've learned a lot about John Lennon talking with you today.
All right, that's brilliant. See you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. If you listened through the whole thing, thank you very much and well done. It's not the easiest thing to listen through a 2-hour podcast, I know.
but I think there were enough, in the words of John Lennon, as we heard in that Iron the Walrus clip earlier, there's enough little biddies to keep you interested for the 2 hours. I just noticed actually that we didn't mention the song Imagine at all among his best ones, both the final list and the other contenders. I think Jason might have mentioned it in part one as saying that it was difficult to judge it among his other material because it's so famous. Anyway, just a couple of things. So just to let you know what is coming up in April, we are going to be going into quite contentious territory. We are going to be looking at the murder / assassination of John Lennon. That may be the next episode, or in fact, I did another guest appearance on the Tomorrow Never Knows podcast with Bob Wilson and Warren Brown. A lot of the stuff we were talking about was very topical, so I might want to get that one out as a bonus first, but lots coming up either way. The thing I always forget to do is to say, please, 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 please subscribe, rate on iTunes or Stitcher, and review as well. 5-star ratings, please, he said grovelingly. Otherwise, you know, please share the show around. You know, it is a lot of work. It's absolutely a labor of love. There's some payoff when you get reviews and things, you know. Us content providers, we need to be told that we're doing a good job and that we're good little boys and girls sometimes. So, you know, the main thing is just it'd be nice to people to hear this because I think it's good stuff and I've had some amazing guests. It's an incredible journey. It's been about 14 months so far and doesn't look like it's going to stop anytime soon. So if you could do that for me, I would be very grateful. So I'm going to leave it for now. I'll see you very soon. Thanks for listening. Take care of yourself in this difficult time. And all the best. Goodbye.
Dream's over, like it's over, you know, and we gotta, well, I have anyway personally, gotta get down to so-called reality, you know.
He was naked in front of his pain, you know, just straight naked, and it was right there all the time, and he had to deal with it.